Good evening. Good evening. I'm Peg Breen from the New York Landmarks Conservancy, and on behalf of my colleagues, Simeon Bankoff from the Historic Districts Council, and Ken Lusbader, who's representing the J.M. Kaplan Fund, I want to welcome you to what we believe will be a very important look at preservation's impact in New York City, and we're delighted to have so many of you here with us. The Conservancy, the HDC, and the Kaplan Fund with the New York Community Trust each commissioned preservation studies last year as we celebrated the 50th anniversary of the city's landmarks law. The Kaplan Fund and the New York Community Trust asked for a just-the-facts statistical look at historic districts. The HDC examined affordable housing in historic districts, and the Conservancy asked for a broad look at everything from local jobs created by preservation to the impact of heritage tourism. Now, if you're in preservation, you believe that landmarking brings benefits to the city, or you wouldn't be doing it. But we also recognize that preservation has lacked hard data to back up or even challenge our beliefs. So these three studies are the most comprehensive look ever at preservation in the city. We'll hear from each of the principals who produced the reports and then have time for questions. You were given note cards as you came in. So as you think of questions, if you would write them down and raise your hand, throughout the whole evening, people will come up and down the aisles to collect them. And then afterwards, we'll have a Q&A. And after that, we'll have a nice reception. Now, please welcome Ken Lusbader to introduce our first speaker.
Thank you, Peg. I'm Ken Lusbader, and up until recently, I've been the Historic Preservation Program Officer of the J.M. Kaplan Fund, which is a family foundation I'm sure many of you are familiar with. For over 70 years, the Kaplan Fund has championed inventive giving that supports transformative social, environmental, and cultural causes. And today, the fund is led by Peter Davidson as chair and Amy Freitag, who sends her regrets that she can't be here, but still continues with its innovative, nimble, and social change through cultural heritage, environmental funding, and immigrants' rights. In late 2014, the fund partnered with the New York Community Trust as funders to jointly support a project produced by the Furman Center to objectively quantify the impact of 50 years of the Landmarks Law. Our goal was to create an accurate data measurements of what has been landmarked with additional metrics to help evaluate and possibly refute what we perceive to be somewhat anecdotal information and measurements. Another goal was to use this information to help guide the next 50 years of the Landmarks Law as public policy. I want to thank Kerry McCarthy of the New York Community Trust for working with me on this grant project and hope that it can be used to enhance preservation in New York City in the short and long term. I'd like to now introduce Ingrid Gould Ellen, who is the Paulette Goddard Professor of Urban Policy and Planning at the Robert Wagner Graduate School of Public Service and the Faculty Director of NYU Furman Center. Ingrid's research centers on neighborhoods, housing, and residential segregation. She is the author of Sharing America's Neighborhoods, The Prospects for Stable Racial Integration, and editor of How to House the Homeless, and has published numerous articles on topics related to urban economics, housing policy, and planning. Ingrid teaches courses in microeconomics, urban economics, and urban policy research, and before going to NYU, she had visiting positions at the Urban Institute and the Brookings Institution. I'd like to now introduce Ingrid.
Thank you, Ken. I'm delighted to be here, and I want to thank, in particular, the New York Community Trust and the Kaplan Fund for supporting this research and the Conservancy for organizing this event. We're excited to be a part of it. We are excited to do this research, very excited when we first had a conversation with Kaplan and Ken and Kerry McCarthy from the New York Community Trust about doing this research. I think that there's we found in sort of beginning to, in sort of perceiving the preservation debates out there, that sometimes there weren't necessarily a shared set of facts. And so we were very happy to just, you know, to explore that on the 50th anniversary of the Landmarks Law in New York. We have released two academic papers, a white paper and a fact brief on historic preservation in the past few months, thanks to this support. I'm going to focus today on key findings from the white paper and from fact brief that accompanied it, that examined the growth in the number of lots and lot area regulated by the Landmarks Preservation Commission, and describe the differences between historic districts and nearby neighborhood. I'm happy to talk about the findings from the academic papers, which examined what happens to property values, neighborhood income, racial composition after historic districts are established, but maybe in the Q&A. But so to start us off, let's look at the location of the city's historic districts. And I'm sorry, this is probably a little hard for you to see, but I hope that you can see that the districts shaded in blue are sort of concentrated in the center of Manhattan and northern Brooklyn. These were the districts that were designated prior to 1995, and those shaded in orange were designated after. And you can see that the districts were heavily concentrated in Manhattan and sections of Brooklyn initially, but over time they have spread further away from core Manhattan. Here we show the growth in the number of lots in historic districts over time, and the alternating colors reflect changes in mayoral administrations. And by the end of 2014, which is when we ended this study, about 28,000 lots were in historic districts in the city, representing about 3.3% of all parcels in New York. On average, that means about 500 lots per year have been added to historic districts. There's obviously been variation across mayoral administrations, and not surprisingly, the growth was most rapid in the very early years. It's important to look at the growth in the number of lots. In some ways, a more useful measure is the growth in the lot area, which better captures how much of the city is regulated through inclusion in a historic district. And the average increase in lot area per year was about 2.5 million square feet over these 50 years, with the administrations of Mayor Wagner, Mayor Dinkins, and Mayor Koch shepherding the largest average increases in lot area during their administrations. In addition to the designation of historic districts, the Landmarks Preservation Commission, or the LPC, also designates individual and interior landmarks. And here, this map shows the growth of lots with individual and interior designations for each decade since 1965. It shows the diffusion of interior and individual landmarks across the city, but again shows the significant concentration in Manhattan. And on this slide, you can see this. I skipped over that. You can see the growth in the number of lots with an interior or individual designation. So let's talk about density and development. I think that the perception is often that historic districts are lower density neighborhoods than sort of newer buildings. But it turns out that there is actually, when we looked at this, there is actually no difference in the built floor area between lots inside and outside of historic districts within a community district, okay? So what we did is we measured what's known as floor area ratio, or FAR, which is the square footage of all floors in the building divided by the area of the lot, okay? And citywide, if you look at historic districts, parcels in historic districts versus those outside, you can see the average historic district lot was actually built to a higher density than the average average lot that wasn't regulated by the LPC. That shows the bar, the red bar here. But in fact, this difference was actually largely due to the concentration of historic districts and high-density neighborhoods in Manhattan and Brooklyn. And once we looked within community district, which is what we tried to do in all these cases, we find that the difference in the difference in floor area ratio disappears. Okay, so basically, the historic district lots have, on average, are built to exactly the same density as other lots outside of districts, but in the same neighborhood or in the same community district. Okay, so despite the perception that historic districts are lower density, they generally are not. That said, in addition to looking at what currently exists, we also wanted to describe differences in construction of new buildings, which might suggest something about density levels in the future. And we found that lots within historic districts were less likely to see the construction of a new building than lots outside of them. This shows, you can see the difference in the bars, it shows that the bars on the, I'm not sure how much you can read, but this is New York City all the way on the left, that set of bars, and then Bronx, Brooklyn, Manhattan, Queens, and Staten Island. You can citywide, fewer than 1% of lots in historic districts had a new building constructed on it between 2004 and 2014, while about 4% of lots that were outside of historic districts had a new building constructed. And this is not surprising. This is what historic districts are trying to do to preserve the existing buildings. But this wasn't just limited to, due to a paucity of vacant or underdeveloped lots in historic districts. We also found that a smaller percentage of residential soft sites, which are vacant lots or buildings that are built to less than half their zoning capacity, a smaller percentage of those residential soft sites within historic district were redeveloped between 2000 and 2014 as compared to lots in the same community district but outside of those historic districts. Importantly, though, that said, we found no difference with respect to alteration activity. And so while there's less new construction in historic districts, we didn't find that there was less investments in maintenance and improvements of existing properties. We looked at building renovations and particularly Alt-1 type permits, which are basically those that add floor area or change the number of units or change the uses. And on average, citywide, historic districts actually saw more activity, more investment activity than lots outside. But that difference disappeared once we looked inside a community district. So in other words, historic districts lots were about equally likely to have had an alteration, receive an alteration type 1 permit as other lots in the same community district, but that were not regulated by LPC. Okay, so what about affordable housing? We're going to hear, Gretchen's going to talk a lot more about affordability in historic districts. I'm just going to show one slide, which is that we examine whether there are differences in the degree to which the share of multifamily rental units that were market rate or in public housing and privately owned housing, subsidized housing, or rent regulated. And we find that historic district rental units were more likely to be rented at market rates than non-LPC regulated units. It was about 57% versus 31%. But much of that difference was rooted in the absence of public housing in historic districts. That was the big driver of that difference. Okay, what about the population? What about the population living inside historic districts as compared to the population living outside historic districts but still in the same community districts? We found that households in historic districts had higher incomes, and significantly higher incomes, than households in non-historic district census tracts. Essentially, what we did is we looked at census tracts, which are small statistical neighborhoods, and we compared the population living in those that were fully covered by historic districts, and then those that had no properties in historic districts. And we found that for census tracts, mostly included in within a historic district, the average income was about $160,000. For census tracts that were outside of historic districts, the average income is about $69,000. So that's a large difference, it's somewhat explained by the concentration of historic districts in Brooklyn and Manhattan, but even within the same community district, we do see those income differences persist. We also found that in historic district census tracts that residents were more likely to have a college degree. For census tracts mostly included within historic districts, 68% of adults over 25 had a college degree as compared to 29% of adults over 25 in non-historic district census tracts. We also found that I'm making sure I'm on track, that we find that in historic district census tracts, residents were also more likely to be non-Hispanic white. For census tracts mostly included within historic districts, 63% of residents were white, as compared to the census tracts outside, just 30% were white. And again, that difference is smaller, but it still persists once we look within community districts. Okay, so before moving, let me just sort of quickly summarize, I think, and again, there's a lot more in our report, but I just wanted to pull out sort of six findings to bring here today. And the first is just simply just sort of, you know, getting the facts straight on the numbers. A lot of numbers get thrown around. And I think, of course, I believe our numbers, which is that 3.4% of lots in New York City were regulated by LBC, were either in historic districts or were individual landmarks. 27% of lots in Manhattan were LPC regulated. Historic district areas had the very same density levels, were built to the same density levels as nearby areas, and I didn't say this, they also had the same population density as nearby areas. Historic districts saw less new construction, but on the other hand, they were equally likely to receive a major alteration permit. So there was no less investment in maintaining and improving the buildings inside of historic districts. Historic districts had a higher market rate, a higher share of the multifamily rental units were market rate. And residents of historic districts were higher income, more highly educated, more likely to be non-Hispanic white than residents of their neighbors in the same area, but that outside of historic districts. So I mean, I hope that is a useful set of facts to set the stage. I think that I think some of these bust some of the myths about historic preservation. But I also think that I think that probably the biggest challenge here to the preservation community, which I hope we can talk about in the Q&A, is the population of the higher socioeconomic status of the population that is living in the neighborhoods that are preserved and regulated. So thank you. I look forward to your questions.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Simeon Bankoff, Executive Director of the Historic Districts Council. HDC is the citywide advocate for New York's historic neighborhoods. Since 1970, we have been serving a constituency of over 500 neighborhood-based groups on preserving the physical character of their neighborhoods, community organizing, and education. In looking forward to the 50th anniversary of the New York City Landmarks Law, my board of directors strongly suggested that we look at the question of affordable housing and historic preservation. We went to we looked around for funders, and we found Kerry McCarthy at the New York Community Trust was very generous in funding this peer-reviewed, peer-reviewed study that we constructed to look at the indices of affordability and historic district designation in order to bring some clarity and bring some kind of bring some mathematical truths to what had become a very, one could say, fraught discussion. So we are very pleased to have found Gretchen Manville of Think Brooklyn. Gretchen came to us from an affordable housing background and from a community development background. She and her team worked with us and worked with a large team of independent reviewers and professionals to produce the study that she will present to you now. Gretchen, please.
Good evening, everyone. First of all, thank you so much to the New York Community Trust, the Kaplan Fund, the Conservancy. Would also like to thank HDC. What Ingrid framed and Simeon then reiterated is that there are a dearth of data. And what a dearth of data means about affordable housing and the intersection of affordable housing with historic districts is that policymaking cannot be data-driven. And we know that data are not the end-all be-all and that the qualitative is important too. But without the data, we don't have a jumping off point for the conversation. So that was the impetus behind this study. And the clicker, yes. So just a quick slide about Think Brooklyn. We were originally formed about 8 years ago as the Center for the Study of Brooklyn. And our tagline is data and strategy for the social good. So Think Brooklyn is community-driven and participatory in its approach. We provide access to affordable, rapid and reliable data analysis, data visualization, assets and needs assessments, strategic planning, program evaluation, community resource directories. Our work empowers nonprofits, government, businesses, researchers, and media in New York City and beyond to develop compelling funding proposals, high impact and sustainable programming and services, and influential advocacy initiatives. Now, so what do we do about this dearth of data? Think Brooklyn was commissioned in July 2014 by the Historic Districts Council to study this intersection of affordable housing and historic districts in New York City from funding from the New York Community Trust. Our primary intent to is ensure that because there was, a vast political spectrum of disagreements and a little bit of tension over the years around this, it was really important to us that we conduct an unbiased, nonpartisan study. And to that end, we began by calling together a core set of research design advisors to help us take a look at methodology, literature reviews, and then we had a larger review committee as well, and they span the spectrum from affordable housing advocates to preservationists, and then all of the various sectors, government, nonprofit, et cetera. Again, we did a thorough review of precedent literature. There was nothing nearly as robust as the study that had been commissioned by us, but there were bits and pieces of precedents of methodology that we could call together to inform our methodology. We did some foundational research regarding the availability and the limitations and the analytic opportunities also of the relevant data sets. We researched and vetted apropos methodologies, and then we began our analysis of census and subsidized housing information project, or SHIP data, from the Furman Center. So a bit about historic districts, and you all might already know all of this, but the first historic district in New York City was designated in 1965, and the most recent is, Simi, in 2015, 16, just done. So there are 138 historic districts, and here you can see the distribution of historic districts by borough. So the overall methodology, we developed research questions for three categories of affordability. Affordability, income, and census—and demographic indicators. So that's one source is from the Census Bureau. The second is from SHIP data, and this is government-subsidized rental housing. The third that we were hoping to be able to analyze is rent-regulated unit data, but we were not able to obtain this from DHCR, and there were a whole host of groups, including the Office of the Manhattan Borough President, that tried to lobby with us, and to no avail. So we explored longitudinal comparative, descriptive, and multiple regression analyses. Comparative means you're comparing one or two or more indicators. Descriptive, mathematical quantities like mean, median, standard deviation. And then multiple regression analyses is a little bit more advanced, and it allows one to estimate the relationship between one or more independent variables to a single dependent variable. It is very important to emphasize that if we find significance or correlation, that does not mean causality. It does not mean that one indicator is causing another. It just means there's a relationship. It's an oftentimes misunderstood piece of regression analysis. So our final methodology was that we conducted comparative and multiple regression analyses of census data. And then for the SHIP data, we performed descriptive analyses. So part one, the US Census Bureau data. We started off knowing there would be a host of challenges, which is probably a reason for the barriers to entry, if you will, into this type of research. First is difficulties with finding a unit of analysis that can adequately measure change within historic districts. Second, an apparent lack of consistent and comparable longitudinal data, so data over time that were consistent. For example, the census may ask a question differently in one year to another. In theory, there's something called harmonization that should even those differences out, but it's still a challenge. The challenge of matching historic district boundaries to the geographic boundaries available from the US Census Bureau. So there's a lot of gerrymandering, not purposeful, but going on with a lot of these geographic boundaries, so that's a big challenge. And then finding suitable, comparable, non-historic district geographies amidst New York City's very varied real estate market. So the research design, again, going a little bit deeper in the multiple linear regression, there's something called ordinary least squares, and I'm happy to tell you all about it if you'd like to stay after the reception, but I won't go into it now. So the research design, there were three indicators. I think we had prepared maybe 20 or so that we suggested that we explored, and then for time and feasibility constraints, we had to narrow it down. So we picked three that we thought were most apropos to start with a recommendation that the other indicators are explored in future research. Those indicators were median contract rent, percentage of households paying 35% or more of income to housing, which is also known as rental burden or lack of affordable housing, and then median household income. And we looked at these longitudinally or over a spread of time, and the years were 1970 to 2010. We had three independent variables, so we were trying to see what the relationship was between these independent variables for each of the dependent variables. That is historic district concentration, timing of designation, and borough. And I think, Ingrid, you, some of those independent variables are similar to the ones that you looked at. And the geographies, we found that there were 175 historic district census tracts, or census tracts with residential units in 81 historic districts in New York City. Now that historic district census tract, that's a mouthful, but what it really means is that we didn't want to just take any census tract, we wanted to make sure there were residential units in it because that's what this is about. So if there was a census tract that was only industrial or light industrial, we didn't include that. So 175 historic district census tracts, 82 in Manhattan, 60 in Brooklyn, and 33 in the Bronx, Queens, and Staten Island, and affectionately named Other. No offense to those three boroughs, but it's just the sample size would have been too small to have them separately. So I apologize to anyone from the Bronx, Queens, and Manhattan. Here's a map just to show you where, as an example of the historic districts and the concentration of residential units. So the orange is residential units, the dark orange that are within the Jackson Heights Historic District, and then we have those without, and then you'll see the white areas were non-residential areas. So major findings for the census data. There are many more details than this, but I'll try to summarize. We found that historic district designation had relatively little bearing on rental prices and the number of rent-burdened households. Remember, rent burden is paying more than 35% of your income for housing. But there was a correlative correlation with an increase in income in some designated historic districts. And I think that's, Ingrid spoke a little bit about higher incomes. So that makes logical sense. So more specifically, we did a basic comparative analysis. That's what we started with. We compared the two things. When we only did the comparative analysis, we found that rent and income increased in census tracts overlapping with historic districts compared to all census tracts in New York City. However, that's leaving out some very important factors which we could throw into the mix when we did the regression analysis. So through that, we actually found that there was no statistically significant relationship of rent and income to the concentration, either high concentration or low concentration, of residential units in historic district census tracts, or the timing of the historic district designation, sorry. So some more major findings, concentration high or low of residential units located in historic districts was not significantly related to the percentage point change of households paying more than 35% of their income. An increase in rental housing burden over 40 years was actually more in all census tracts for all of New York City and in each of the five boroughs, so we looked at all of NYC and then the boroughs separately, compared to those census tracts that overlapped with historic districts. Now this is counter to, I think, conventional wisdom and is an interesting point. So this graph here shows the percentage point increase over the 40-year spread in rental burden. And so you'll see that for New York City, it's about twice as much, Manhattan twice as much, Brooklyn twice as much, and other, it's about 25% more. Now, some could say, well, this is because of attributable to the higher incomes, but this is something to be investigated further. So recommendations for future research for the census data. Explore various weighting methodologies because we need to be cognizant of differences in population density. Expand analysis to include additional non-districted but adjacent-like census tracts. Procure and analyze the more targeted and smaller geographies of block group data. So if you have census tract, then your block groups are a subset of the census tract, so you can get even more precise with your analysis. Incorporate the analysis additional historic districts designated after 2010. So remember, this is just through 2010, and that has to do with the availability of the data. Analyze the performance of additional affordability and income indicators as dependent variables, so all those other indicators we wanted to but didn't have time to. Adjust the time period, so you're looking in smaller increments to see if that has an effect. Look at change in counts of historic districts over time for a particular census tract, and analyze historic district and non-district areas that currently have comparable median income levels and compare the rates of increase in those areas over time in order to further dive into causality versus just correlation. So part two, building level affordability indicators. This is the SHIP data. Again, we were hoping to look at the DHCR data. Didn't happen. Lots of lobbying went on, and unfortunately didn't pan out, but we encourage all of the players to try to continue to get those data. SHIP data, 10.7% or 234,000 units of rental units in New York City. These represent the known universe of data available regarding privately owned and publicly subsidized rental housing in New York City, so not public housing. Building level data are important because one can readily determine by geocoding and mapping addresses whether or not a building is inside or outside an historic district. So that's what we need to know for the analysis. So we constructed a data set using SHIP data. We merged that with LPC data to make sure there were no discrepancies, and we addressed some of those with both staff to ensure that it was as accurate as possible. And then we mapped the borough block lot data for the SHIP data onto historic districts. So a lot of overlays there. Oh, I think I accidentally just. Okay, so SHIP data tracks privately owned, publicly subsidized rental housing. It contains 2,500 developments, 5,000 buildings, and 235,000 rental units. It tracks four major subsidy programs. So the methodology was, again, mapping SHIP buildings on historic districts, looking at the building block and lots, which were within the boundaries of historic districts. Those were selected. We built the new data set. We added missing SHIP data from publicly available sources, and then we conducted a descriptive analysis. So we did not do a comparative or regression analysis with the SHIP data, just the descriptive. So there are lots of government subsidy programs, so one development can have more than one subsidy source, that's important to know. Subsidies last from several to over 30 years. Some subsidies are renewable, others are not, which is important to know, because if building owners opt out, they might be opting out just because the term of the subsidy and their agreement to keep the housing affordable is over, and not for any other reason other than that. And Furman's New York City's State of New York City's housing report cites that owners are more likely to opt out during economic booms. So we looked at our HD SHIP rental development rates similar or dissimilar to trends in SHIP rental development rates and in areas outside of historic districts. Are subsidies maintained at similar rates, and are there differential development or maintenance subsidy rates based upon the borough or community districts? There are 30 historic districts with a total of 96 BBLs. There's a higher percentage of subsidized units developed in Manhattan, Brooklyn, and Staten Island historic districts than in non-designated areas in these boroughs, whereas Queens and the Bronx had more subsidized units developed outside of historic districts. Historic district designation did not prevent subsidized housing from being developed in specific neighborhoods. That's very important to note, as over a quarter of the nearly 4,000 subsidized rental units were developed after historic designation was the historic district was designated. So I think that's a really important point. So here are some tables illustrating this. You can see Bronx, Brooklyn, Manhattan. You can see in Brooklyn and Manhattan how the percentages are higher for within historic districts for development and lower outside, and the converse is true for Bronx. Queens had none, and Staten Island. Subsidized units in many historic districts remain affordable whether or not the units were developed before or after historic designation. Overall, in New York City, affordability subsidies are maintained for rental units as of 2010 in historic district at a rate of 74.6%, which is almost exactly the same as rates in non-designated areas. And again, we talk about the reasons for the subsidies ending for the remaining 25% are the owner maybe wanted to get additional subsidies and couldn't, or they simply decided to opt out of the program. Subsidized rental units in historic districts have maintained subsidies at higher rates. Bedford-Stuyvesant is a really interesting example. 100% of historic district rental units maintain their subsidies despite having earlier average start dates than overall subsidized rental units in that same community district. Manhattan's historic districts are less likely to have maintained affordability subsidies than the city as a whole, with the exception of Central Harlem, where subsidies have been maintained for longer periods of time. And this is just illustrating the maintenance of subsidies, so how long these projects kept their subsidy, and then for the specific neighborhoods. So recommendations for future research for looking at privately owned, publicly subsidized rental data. Well, first let's start with the rent regulated. So keep trying to get the DHCR data. That's a huge chunk of the stock in New York, and it's really important to know what's going on with that. And then if you get the data, analyze changes in rent-stabilized units in historic districts and comparable neighborhoods, starting at the early 1990s, which is when the data are mostly available from. For the SHIP data, taking a look at adjacent comparable neighborhoods would be a great next step. Accounting for zoning and looking at the rate and spatial distribution of opt-outs and then overlaying that inside and outside of historic districts. And that's it. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Andrea Goldwyn, Director of Public Policy for the Conservancy. At the Conservancy, we've always been aware of the tremendous impact that preservation has had on New York, helping the city thrive after the 70s financial crisis, bringing people back to live here, fueling the tourism boom, providing stability after the most recent recession, and welcoming the growing tech sector. But so much of this information was anecdotal. We wanted the numbers to back up those claims. As the Landmarks Law anniversary approached, and preservation was under attack from a fresh round of criticisms which claimed that too much of the city was landmarked, or that preservation was preventing economic growth, the time seemed right to commission a study that would examine the data, reframe the discussion on preservation's role in the city's development up to this point, and looking forward. We're very pleased to engage Donovan Ripkema, the principal of Place Economics, and his fantastic team. Place Economics is a real estate and economic development consulting firm specializing in neighborhood revitalization and reuse of historic structures. They've worked all across the country, 49 states, and the District of Columbia, with several statewide studies. And their sister firm, Heritage Strategies International, provides these services across the world. Donovan has been in this field for over 30 years. He's the author of numerous articles and publications. His book, The Economics of Historic Preservation, A Community Leader's Guide, was one of the first I bought starting grad school, and I imagine many of you have read it. He teaches at Penn and has delivered courses and workshops to architects, bankers, preservationists, planners, downtown managers. And in 2012, the National Trust awarded him their highest honor, the Crown and Shield Award. Place Economics has produced an engaging report that covers broad issues and fine points of how preservation intersects with New York's economy. It goes deep into the ways that landmarking has benefited New York, presented in a lively and attractive format, and we hope that this report will set a milestone in this discussion and start new conversations. And here with the highlights is Donovan Ripkema.
Thanks, Andrea. Very nice, mostly untrue, but greatly appreciated. Thank you all for being here. We love this assignment. Which way? There we go. I hope this doesn't seem like the eternal economic seminar, but no guarantee about it. The Landmarks Conservancy was a great client of this, and Andrea and Peg were invaluable in that they got us access to human beings that we wouldn't have been able to do, and their conscious strategy was, we certainly talked to plenty of preservationists and preservation advocates. The kind of way we framed it is, we might not have talked to the atheists, but we talked to lots of agnostics about this, people who weren't on the prayer page for preservation, and learned a lot. My colleagues, Emily Evans, who's here, and Brianna Paxton did great research and design work. Any mistakes that are in the report, or any errors in fact or judgment that are not the Landmarks Conservancy or their mine. Also, I have to say that we couldn't have done this work at all without the great help and tutoring and correcting and fine-tuning that Gretchen and her colleague Eric did for us. And we really based our analysis based on this seminal stuff that they've now done to get the real answers of what in fact is under preservation. So anyway, that's where we started in this. But I have to do two little prefatory remarks. First is that Emily, my colleague, lives here in New York on the Upper West Side, a couple blocks from here. And I haven't spent much time, but I came up earlier today, and we spent it in the Upper East Side. And I recall this quotation: those preservationists fighting for area-wide district designation may unwittingly drain the vitality they wish to perpetuate. Well, that came from the Real Estate Board of New York when the Upper East Side Historic District was being created, and nothing about this felt like a place. I've been in plenty of places that have had the vitality drained out. This didn't seem to be one of those to me. The second thing, and I probably am getting myself in trouble in New York City, I have to tell you that I am not an opera fan. I don't know anything about it. I don't go to the opera. But the Wagner's Ring Cycle is now playing in Washington. And there was an article in the Washington Post a couple weeks ago by the Post's art and architecture critic, and he coined this phrase in description that called the zombie cultural symbol. And it was really about this, that Brunhilde, in fact, hasn't for decades been played by a stout woman with a fake Viking helmet and horns sticking out. And yet that has become this ongoing kind of mockery of opera. And here is what he wrote: it is a zombie cultural symbol that circulates with rapaciously undead and destructive power, caricaturizing vital and living traditions with ideas that haven't had currency for decades. And when I read that description, that's what's being done to historic preservation across the country in general, in New York City in particular. The way that preservation is being framed, That is this elitist activity of rich white women in tennis shoes, elderly though they may be, that's a caricature of a preservation. If it was ever true, it hasn't been true for decades, and yet we're sucked into this argument of having to defend, oh, that's not what historic preservation is. And I hope one of the things that these studies will do, and this I'm just thrilled at these at this trio of reinforcing studies, will get over that. I do have to tell you kind of in advance on some numbers. You will see me present some numbers on things like income levels in historic districts, racial distribution in historic districts, density in historic districts that are different somewhat than what you heard from Ingrid. That does not mean she is right and I'm wrong or vice versa. It is because we were working off the same data and we based our numbers based on what are historic districts on what the Furman had done. It's really looking at a different scale. And I'll talk about that as we go forward. But I want to start out with kind of with the map that you saw from Ingrid. See the little colored marks on that? That is this giant evil historic preservation, 4% of the land area of all of New York, that somehow is preventing development, stopping affordable housing. The end of the world is coming because those little, now if you argued that with the white area, it might make sense. Those little colored parts are this great evil villain of historic preservation that's causing so much trouble. And I want to look at the kind of residual of the numbers that that we heard from Ingrid, is that 3% of the lots of the city of New York under the protection of the Landmarks Commission, that means that 97% aren't under that protection. That 4% of the lot area is under protection, that means that 96% in fact is not. And this kind of idea that somehow this little tiny sliver of the land area in New York is preventing these, preventing development, stymieing development, precluding affordable housing is sheer absolute unequivocal nonsense. I don't feel strongly about that, but I just mentioned it. Even then, when you look at Manhattan, where you have 25% of the lots and about 15% of the land area, or 20 plus the, another 5% in individual designations, even in Manhattan, you have 80% of the land area in lots, in fact, not at all under the purview of the Landmarks Commission. And then when you say, well, here's this, you know, here's this Landmarks Commission, this is Damocles' sword over all the population of New York. Well, in fact, in Manhattan, about 26% of you who live in Manhattan are within a historic district, 75% aren't. And in each of the other four boroughs, in fact, fewer than 10% of the population lives in historic districts. But then the real estate people, they're smart people, no question about that, and they anticipated this argument. And so earlier, last year, earlier this year, here was their statement. Preservationists have noted that with only 3.64% of the city under LPC jurisdiction, 96% of the properties are available for development. This statement ignores the reality that two-thirds of all properties are zoned one or two family housing. Wait a minute. If the problem that we can't have more high-rises is that two-thirds of the city is under one and two family, then the problem is low-density residential zoning, not historic preservation. That's 20 times the problem as historic districts. But there's not the political will or the political courage or the pick-your-own adjective to take on picking on one and two family homeowners. And so using the zombie cultural symbol, it's easier to pick on preservation and say, you're the problem, other than two-thirds of the land that's in low-density residential development. Well, the other thing that's kind of mythological is that somehow the city's preservation commission is somehow a burden and stopping things from happening and is a big bureaucratic nightmare going forward, that it's this kind of preservation commission that does nothing but say no. Well, here's the reality. We looked over the last decade's worth of decisions at the Landmarks Commission, is that 95% of all the applications that come there are handled over the counter at a staff level. They don't even go to the Landmarks Commission. So that leaves about 5% that even have to appear before the Landmarks Commission. And lo and behold, all the applications that go to the Landmarks Commission, 0.3% are denied. This certainly doesn't look like a statistical pattern, this precluding development from taking place in the city of New York. Well, that's kind of the background on how preservation works here, and then I want to go into some kind of factoids in the areas we looked at. And one of those is these kind of combined issues of jobs and resiliency. What does it mean? What's happened in a historic district? Just people hammering hammers and nailing nails. Well, our best guess is that over the last 4 or 5 years, there's been an average of about $865 million of investment in New York's historic districts. And what that translates into is almost 9,000 jobs and almost $600 million in paychecks for people in the city of New York from the work that's being done in your historic districts. And then we had this big crash, the real estate crash. And the blue line is all private construction in the city of New York. The green line is activity inside historic districts. And look what happened. So the big crash starts at the end of 2007. Immediately, construction work tumbles, goes down almost 40% before it starts recovering. There was in historic districts, the decline started later. It was less steep. The recovery started sooner, so there were people working. There would have been about 1,600 people a year without jobs in the city of New York had the decline in activity in historic districts been at the same rate as it was overall. Then the other thing to note about the chart, look at the last 3 years where the real estate construction industry growing crazy. Well, it's a volatile industry, and I'm from the real estate world. I'm pro-development, pro-real estate. What this says with this booming is there's no big barrier to real estate development taking place. My God, it's going like crazy. Well, there's another element that historic districts do, and they serve as a magnet for jobs. The real estate industry is a very important industry. It's a good industry in the city of New York. It's just that it's not the only industry. And let's look at some of the others. So I'm a small business guy, and I know Wall Street's in New York City, and there's big, corporate people here. But the real job growth comes from little guys, not big guys. That's where job growth comes. And what has happened? So in historic districts in the city of New York, about 8% of all of the private sector jobs are within historic districts. But about 8%. Almost 10% of small firm jobs, that's firms employing fewer than 20 people, over 10% of startup firms, and almost 11% of young firms, that's firms that started up in the last 3 years, are in historic districts. So those young startup and small firms disproportionately choose historic districts in where to open and stay open in their business. In the food and beverage industry, again, 8% of all private jobs are in historic district. Almost 13% of the jobs in hospitality industries is in historic districts. So this is kind of businesses in general, but what about those particularly targeted kinds of industries, knowledge-based industries, creative jobs, industries? What does that look like? Well, once again, 8% of all private jobs in historic districts. 10% of professional, scientific, and technical services, 14% of information jobs, 14% of educational services, and 20% of the jobs in arts, entertainment, and recreation are in historic districts, disproportionately attracting from historic districts for those creative and knowledge-based jobs. And it's not just that they're areas that are growing. Here's three of those categories: information, professional, scientific, and technical services, and arts, entertainment. In the last decade, there have been huge growths in the city of New York in those three industrial categories, but in all three of them, in fact, there's been a greater rate of growth inside historic districts. And then related is this issue of heritage tourism. Now, tourism's always a tough one, and all the definitions are kind of fuzzy. We bought a data set from Longwood, a big research firm that does surveys on tourism usage, and we defined heritage tourists as those who came to New York in the previous 90 days and who either went to places like an historic site or historic place or had a strong interest area, and we said those we'll call heritage tourists, and we'll contrast those with visitors who came to New York and didn't do any of those things. Well, what we learned was about 30%, a little over 30% of day visitors, and about 40% of overnight visitors would fall into the heritage tourist category. But here's what's important about that. The activity just from those heritage visitors generates over $700 million in taxes for the city of New York, and that it has workers and it has jobs in the millions, 140,000 jobs in the city of New York as a result of the expenditures of heritage tourists to the city. And then we have the environment. And you know, there's the big initiative started in the last mayor to ultimately make New York the greenest city in the world. And Bloomberg, good businessman that he was, said we need to start out doing an audit of seeing where we are. So we're gonna do giant energy audits of buildings, office buildings and multifamily buildings, all of the city of New York, and something that's continued. It wasn't ever done for preservation purposes. It was done saying, where's the energy use? Where's the energy going? Well, we looked at that data. And in fact, contrary to what we're often told about those old leaky, windblown historic buildings, they're big energy hogs, we gotta tear them down to get some green gizmo lean certified building. In fact, the opposite is true. In fact, the older the building, the less energy use there is per square foot. In fact, a multifamily building built prior to 1930, in fact, uses 13% less energy per square foot than a building built subsequent to 1980. So we want to throw those away to throw out the energy savers of the city of New York? I don't think so. And then this issue about neighborhoods. And again, here's some kind of interesting comparisons. And again, it's just scale at where we're looking at these numbers. We looked at income distributions in historic districts. We looked at racial distribution and ethnic distribution in historic districts. And we aggregated them by borough. And again, this, as Gretchen mentioned, and both Gretchen and Ingrid mentioned, some of this is kind of getting rid of the conventional wisdom that in fact is simply wrong. So we looked at both households with incomes greater than $150,000 a year and households with incomes less than $50,000 a year is kind of the end points. Now, in Manhattan and in Brooklyn, on the income side, in fact, there's a greater propensity for people at the upper income level and a lower propensity of people at the lower income level to live in historic districts. In the other three boroughs, in fact, it's a toss-up. In some cases, there's a greater concentration of lower income categories in historic districts than the others. And again, the difference between Ingrid's data and ours is simply the scale that we're looking at. We're looking at all of the historic districts in Brooklyn or the Bronx or whatever. When we look at racial distribution and Hispanic population, virtually the same. So we have a case, so the yellow numbers, the yellow charts are the historic districts. The green are in unprotected areas. And what you're seeing is that once again, in the Manhattan and Queens, there is a greater likelihood of the white population in historic districts being greater than the white population of the borough as a whole. In the other three, in fact, is either a toss-up, in fact, a greater propensity of black population in historic districts. On the income side, on the Hispanic side, it's the same way, is that there's a skew in Manhattan. But what's happening, because Manhattan has the largest number of people living in historic districts, Manhattan numbers, and particularly the Upper East Side and the West Village, are skewing the data citywide. And when you drill down at the borough level, in fact, the conventional wisdom just is, in fact, neither conventional nor wisdom. Then there's this issue of density. And again, Ingrid's and my numbers are, it's not that they're different, it's looking at a different scale. And here was the comparison we made. And we started with the comparison of skyscrapers. We looked at all of the skyscrapers built between 2000 and 2014, and we looked at the census block groups around, which is the farthest we could drill down around the skyscrapers that were built. And we looked at the big ones, and there were, you know, lots of them built over that time period, as you know better than I. And so when they say, well, we got to have these skyscrapers because they add density, absolutely true. Absolutely true. In these census block groups, that before the skyscraper was built, they had a density of 9,700 people per square mile. After it was built, they had a density of 104,000 people. So, yeah, they're adding lots of density. No question about that. Until we compare them with what happens to, as compared to historic districts. And there's Manhattan. There's Manhattan. So the borough as a whole has a density of about 80,000 people per square mile. The skyscraper census blocks, 104. Look at the historic districts, 145,000 per square mile. And it's true in every borough. In every borough, we compared the density for the borough of as a whole, for the borough that for the zoned area in the borough that allowed residential development, that were not historic districts, and historic districts. In every instance, the density in historic districts were not more just more dense; it was decidedly more dense. Now, if New York needs more density, and maybe it does, for God's sake, don't be going to the places that are already the densest in the city. Look for low-density places to start adding density. Now, this is somehow a kind of prohibition, a preclusion of adding housing in New York. These historic districts is 4% of the land's keeping us from building more housing. What nonsense. While one part of the real estate industry is whining because they can't build high rises in the middle of your historic district, the rest, mostly smaller scale guys, are just doing it. They're not talking about it. They're not whining. They're doing it. They're building houses. And more housing built last year in the city of New York than in decades, if ever. This doesn't sound like a description of an area where, in fact, housing is not taking place. So the issue is, The zombie cultural symbol simply is not the case. There has been this argument, okay, we got these historic districts we have, but we're worried now about more going out there, more in the outer boroughs being designated, and that's eaten up all this land. Well, what's happening is that in the last two decades, most of the historic districts that have been added in the city of New York were in fact to tell the story of the rest of New York. To tell the stories about African American and Hispanic and gay and lesbian, a whole range of communities in New York who deserve their story to be told. And those buildings and those newer historic districts, in fact, are the physical manifestation of the history. And for those who say, like Ed Glaser, oh, we could shrink it, we should only have 5,000 designated buildings, are really saying the rest of those stories are not important. The only stories that are important are the, you know, Chrysler Building and the Empire State Building. The rest don't matter. I don't believe that that's true. I don't believe that you think that's true. That is absolutely a zombie cultural symbol and has no basis in historic preservation in New York. Thank you very much.
I didn't get any question cards passed up. Are there no, here we go. Can somebody, any other questions out there? We've answered everything. Here we go. Somehow asking you to write may not have been the best idea, but we'll do our best here. This is a question for Think Brooklyn. Affordable housing and rent burden. The fact that income has increased in historic districts may affect the proportion of rent burden units. That is, the higher the income, the lower proportion of rent with respect to income.
Yes, that is absolutely right, and I think I mentioned that during the presentation that it might be attributable to that. But there are a lot of other factors influencing that dynamic, and so that's why one of the recommendations for future research is to drill down more deeply into those relationships and make sure that we're controlling for all of those independent variables that have to do with the dynamics that are happening here. So those three independent variables that we looked at, timing of designation, location of historic district, those are just three of what could be many powers at play here. So it's really important that we acknowledge that, yes, that it could be attributable to that. But then, again, we're talking about correlation, even if it is, and not necessarily causality.
Can I just jump in on that? Mm-hmm. I mean, sure. I think one interesting point, Gretchen, is that and I'm drawing from actually the academic papers that I didn't talk about today, but we looked at we sort of, you know, used more fancy statistical methods to try to actually look at the causality and look at the impact of historic districts on property values and rents. And we found, we did find impacts on property values that after the designation, that the designation of historic districts did seem to, at least outside of Manhattan, lead to higher prices. Now you can interpret that in different ways, right? But what's interesting, granted, the data on rents are not as good as the data. We have really good data on property values, so I'm confident in that. The data on rents that Gretchen had to work with are not as good, but we didn't actually see much of a change in rents. And I think that's sort of interesting because I think we always think prices and rents move in lockstep, but prices really, when you buy a home, you're buying into the long-term future of a community, right? And so I think that people are willing to pay for that certainty that they know that neighborhood is going to be preserved over time. And I think for a renter, you're not going to value that quite as much as a homeowner that's buying into a neighborhood. So I think that could be one factor explaining why property values, prices may go up, home prices, sales prices may go up more than rents do.
Just tell you anecdotally, we bought our house in Crown Heights, Brooklyn, coming in on 11 years ago, and prices shot up well in advance of the historic districting of the 1-2 and those neighborhoods. So just one personal anecdote, but
yeah, the prices rise before and then they rise. Yeah. It does look like they rise more after than you would have predicted,
right,
compared to other neighborhoods.
Right, and doing those time incremental studies that I mentioned as a recommendation for future research, that's part of why that's so important, is to break it down into
absolutely.
Those sections.
No,
more.
That's what you have to do. You have to look
right.
before and after.
And Donovan, this sounds like it should be for you, because you were talking about telling the rest of the stories. And the question is, please discuss how the non-built environment, sites without building, can add to our understanding of the New York experience. They're speaking, for instance, of Native American sites. Native American sites.
Well, I wish I would have a better answer than I do, and because I'm kind of a geeky numbers guy, and from the real estate world, I think in terms of four walls and a roof. Having said that, in the kinds of research both we've done here and elsewhere, this more intangible heritage has a significant impact, not necessarily on property values or those things that we usually measure, but in terms of people's attachment to the area, the issues of people's feeling that this neighborhood represents their story, and it might not be the buildings in this neighborhood, but the character and the quality of the neighborhood. The challenge is that the tools for measuring these intangibles are less sophisticated and less known. And we kind of take an anthropologist as opposed to an economist to look at. But I think that those are really an emerging area that people more around the world than here, frankly, are looking at, of this really important role that this the story part of it, the intangible, the kind of quote softer side, really manifests itself in lots of things like neighborhood attachment that has all kinds of measures, including things like voter participation and crime rates and socialization and participation in neighborhood groups is really driven by those things. It's just a lot tougher to measure.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, I'm going to take this opportunity to say, because I forgot to say earlier, that the work that I did was co-authored with Eric Stern, who's at the Furman Center with me, and with Brian McCabe, who's a sociologist at Georgetown. And I have been talking to Brian because there is such a dearth of sort of qualitative research that to try to really get at what is the experience of people in historic districts. And I think, and he does some quantitative research like this, but he also does qualitative research. And I think he is beginning a project. And I hope that we need to learn a lot more about that.
Speaking of the need for more data, here's the conspiracy question. Is the DHCR rent regulation data a game changer? And then, if so, what's the holdup?
That's for me. I think we could all answer.
Yes.
So I don't know what the holdup is. I do know that there are a few agencies in New York that do have access to the data, but because of the contracts that they have with DHCR, they weren't allowed to share those data, even though they wanted to be able to. Because at the end of the day, these data, they may be a game changer. We don't know. And at the very least, it's important that we have all of the information at our fingertips. And so there was a lot of lobbying that was done to try to get these data and access to these data, which are supposed to be publicly available, but are not. I don't think there's necessarily anything, egregious or there's malintent around the situation. I just think it's something that needs to be pushed through so that we can really have the most informed discourse about this as possible. And there, to my estimation, there's no reason why these data shouldn't be available and analyzed.
There are apparently there's some provisions in the rent stabilization law that that protect the confidentiality of the data. Now, whether or not those data, we can talk about whether those, protections should be there, but there are some provisions in the law which actually constrains the ability of DHCR to share, to share the data. And I think, I will say that, one of our former fellows at the Furman Center, John Krause, has now, at least in New York sort of geek data circles, has sort of famously now scraped the data off the website. And we did use those data, and, they're not perfect, but we did find that we did an analysis that I didn't talk about today that looked sort of longitudinally and showed that rent-stabilized apartments are no more likely to exit rent stabilization in historic districts than parcels that are outside historic districts but still in the same neighborhood. And so, that I think that is, it would be great if we could get the real data from HCR, the official data, but I think that, those data did come from the HCR website.
We tried to get part of the data from another agency, and they thought that their data set was full and robust and accurate, and in fact, there were extraordinary gaps, and so we just decided. So that's, it's a tribute to the tenacity of your colleague that they scraped the data, so that's great. But hopefully, oftentimes with data, if one can sign an agreement that says you won't disaggregate the data to the extent that folks can be identified, then you can still use the data. So maybe that's an option in the future.
Okay, so given the time, this is going to be our final question because we do have a reception to go to, but we'll start with you, Donovan, and I think you'll all want to answer this eventually. It's great to be able to counter lies or misrepresentations with facts, but as we can see with recent attempts to respond to the rise in the influence of Donald Trump, being right isn't always enough. So what's next?
I will give it my best shot at that. Two things that we have learned in doing studies like this other places. Number one is that the data in the report itself is maybe half of the value. The other half is when the report is delivered to the client is aggressive means of distribution of that information. I don't think you can ever use these guys have just fabulous peer-reviewed, defensible data. I don't care for the those who don't want to believe, they're not going. It doesn't make any difference. But you don't worry about that. You worry about getting those who are on the fence, who don't know, who really have a real open mind about, oh, geez, that's different than I understood. So I think that's important. And I think the real advantage in the city of New York, unlike any other place in America, is that you have so many really good, knowledgeable, connected, articulate preservation organizations when armed with, in fact, quantitative data, can start like you've always done, knocking on doors, buttonholing people, having lunch and saying, this is the real deal. And I think that gradually it'll start making a change.
So I'm going to jump off of what you said around looking at the peer review model and reaching consensus and having a lot of bright people thinking about this and talking about this. We all know that anyone can make data say anything they want it to, right? And particularly when you're looking at sound bites and cliches, and some of these issues are extremely complicated and nuanced and don't necessarily lend themselves to the tagline or the promotions that might be convenient for media campaigns, et cetera. And so I think the number one thing that we need to make sure that we do moving forward is to consistently have transparency and models where we have research design advisors and all the bright minds sitting around at the table, rather than one-off studies where the sources of data and methodology are not even included. And then those get picked up in the media with the happy sound bites and folks are swayed. So I'm not mentioning any names, but that's my forecast for the future.
So I think I'm going to pass the buck a little bit. I do feel like sitting where I am in a university and directing a research center that is not an advocacy organization, I think our mission is really to provide a rigorous set of rigorous evidence about on policy, on issues that really matter to policy. I'm on the faculty of a policy school, and I'm faculty director of an urban policy center, but again, we are not an advocacy organization, and so I think that I think our job is to produce sort of rigorous research. I hope that we can establish a shared set of facts that can push the debate further and help to inform policymaking. But we are very happy when the advocacy community wants to use our data and our evidence to move their arguments forward, though.
Well, speaking on behalf of the Conservancy, and I'm sure on behalf of HDC and the other preservation organizations, we found this incredibly a valuable thing to do. We realized that we could have started a lot earlier, but I think we can pledge to you that we will try to maintain this and keep up with our wonderful panelists and keep producing data that makes the case. So let's thank them all, and let's go to a reception through this door. Reception up front and door to the right.